Hello, and welcome to the first episode of A Tale of Two Worlds. Now, today we're going to be talking about sister worlds. And this is in a solar system far, far away, but right next to you as well. So, it's not in a galaxy far, far away, but it's just in another timeline. We'll figure out how to say that later in the book. But anyway, this is my audio-video version first because I'm too lazy to write it. So anyway, we got the tale of two worlds. It's sister planets. One has a small moon, and then the other, which is the second rock from the sun, Armanda, has two moons. And we're going to start on Armanda right now and describe their world a little bit to you. You know how we have mostly green trees and green plants here? Well, on Armanda, they had mostly reddish-purple leaves there, and a few green ones. And then some of the more special ones could process the sun's energy through photosynthesis in a multi-colored sort of way. And, you know, it's, I don't know the science of all of it, but I know that the green and the purple, and we also had every other color that could process the photosynthesis on Armanda. Now, some strange creatures there that we're not used to here. Like, for instance, I know this has been done a million times, the Ewoks, the Hobbits, the Lollipop Gill, Anyway, the little people on The Wizard of Oz. Seems like every story has to have some little people. But these little people were different than the Hobbit and, you know, all of the fictional ones like the Ewoks. They were sort of a blend. You take and you put all the little ones from all of the movies together, pour them into a big vat of DNA and churn it up and pull a strand of DNA back out, and you have got yourself an Olamaian. And they were the original inhabitants of Armanda. And the sky was like a magenta color. And the most amazing creature that we had there was one that could shift shape, and she could shapeshift by absorbing the energy from others' genetic codes. And if she was shapeshifting from like a big old dragon looking thing, like humongous, then since energy is neither created nor destroyed, it would. And there was only one that I ever met while I was there. And she would absorb, like, say she's going from the size of a little drunk frog, about yay big or so. Look on Uncle Goat Show and see the drunk frog. It used to live here in my kitchen. I don't know where she went now. I think she may be a cat right now, but you never know. But anyway, when she would start to shift from a small creature into a ginormously huge, sorry, I had to get that pun in there. Anyway, into a gigantically huge beast, then like going from a frog to a dragon, since energy is neither created nor destroyed in this universe, she has to pull the life force from everything that is alive around her. from the plants, the fungus, the bugs. But before this happens, she sets out an ultrasonic frequency that causes all of the animals, and she does it accordingly to the size that she's going to need, so that all animals, all mammals and reptiles and amphibians and some that y'all have no idea of can get out of the way. Like, for instance, here is one of the creatures that walks among the forest in Armanda, in the Alamein village. Right here, you see those? It's akin to the arachnid on the sister world Terra. But anyway, I think this thing is absolutely terrifying. Look where it grabbed hold of something, still got blood on its tentacles. Right there. But anyway, that was the darkness coming through there. Anyway, it's also got a tentacle stinger tail right here that it keeps loaded, and you think it can't reach you with that? And then its third eye right here, see, it's got one big eye, and my camera keeps going dark. Darn that darkness. There we go. There, look into the third eye. I mean, the big eye. One big eye, and it's got like eight dots around it. But it's got this thing on top of its head that comes in and out, and it feels around like this, and it judges distance. And this is basically located where our pineal gland is. So these are pretty in touch, crazy little critters, and they scurry around the forest of Armanda. Well, anyway. Oh, I forgot to show you its little, every one of its legs can curl up like that right there. Y'all see that critter and see them legs? It can curl them up, and it's like a shrimpelopod that is able to be aquatic or terrestrial. So it's a crazy little critter. Reminds me of a cuttlefish mixed with a black widow spider. So anyway, another one of the creatures there. Well, I told you about the Alamans, and I told you about them critters. I don't even think it translates. I'll have to figure something out. A shrimpelopod, I guess, is what it is.
You need to spray her down with this and give her a bath.
Yep, I need to.
Not
Oh,
to where she's
let me
dripping
see her.
and damp.
Okay.
I put a little bit of it on her head.
All right. Now, right here is one of my cohorts. She is very familiar with our Amanda, and see that beat that creature I was telling you about, the shapeshifter. She could just as easily be a cat or a frog, and she'll put out those feelers and everything, and all the animals will get out of the way, and the plants don't mourn their passing. Because so they sacrifice their self and their energy to help her, because she is a good creature. She always does good. She's a creature of the light. So all the animal life, the carbon breathers, I mean the oxygen breathers, get out of the way, and then the carbon breathers stay there. So what happens then is she will absorb all that energy from the carbon breathers, and they give it freely, and then she goes into this undulating blob of mess that is just psychedelic with every color that you could imagine. Sort of like a bubbling cocoon. And inside that membrane, she rearranges the DNA of the creature that she wants to become, and hatches out of it within it happens almost in the twinkling of an eye, but you can, she has to do it fast sometimes. But anyway, let's get back to the Alamein there. We've covered the shrimpelopod, and we've covered little bit of the Olamay, and let me tell you how where they live is very similar to the way the hobbits live and the Dakini live off of, what was that there, Willow movie, and, you know, all of these natural peoples. Okay, bamboo grew on both worlds. And we had different species of bamboo. But anyway, as the bamboo grows, you can bend it over. There's different types of bamboo, but what they would do, they'd bend it over and they would weave the branches together like a vine intertwining on each other. And that would make a structure. Now, once they got that done, they would take like lily pads and moss and lay it on the joints where these limbs are still alive and everything, but it's got strips, and then moss starts to form in there. And then as a year or so goes by, they get it completely waterproof. They put more on top of it, and then it, like the new shoots that come up, they'll bring those around, they'll lay them across the top of it, and that will create a mat. Now, with that mat that they've put on top of it, it just wilts down and naturally forms to it. As time goes by, then it'll rot, and through a permaculture process, through mycelium and bacteria and, you know, all sorts of good things, you end up with it turning to soil pretty quick. And then they pile moss on top of there, and they grow hydroponically their, you know, fruits and everything. And unlike hobbit holes, it does have roots and ends of worms hanging through. But that's a good thing. You know, the Olamayan people, they love to eat the worms. And, you know, they could spray water out of them, and they would water the roots on the inside of that. You know, if I build one, I'll build one of these and show y'all. But I'll have a spray bottle, and I'll go out every morning, and I'll spray those roots that are going up. And we can like have tomatoes and hydroponic lettuce and all sorts of things growing on it. And anyway, on the inside there, you know, you'll have a good cool place. But anyway, that's the way the Olamayan do. You know, they are like floating on the lakes and the rivers and stuff like that. So anyway, oh, let me show you this here. Jewelry right here. What are you doing there, Sam? See this there jewelry? Now this is sort of like the necklaces that is their Olamayan Armandan wedding necklaces. When they get married, instead of like we do here, you may kiss the bride. You know, one of them's got this on. Here, you have this on, girl. And the other has this and on. They have their ceremony out in the woods, and they come together. And if the stones jump and touch each other, then they're married. If they don't touch each other, then it wasn't meant to be. Don't ask me some silly something. I think it's just the north and south poles of the magnets. But anyway, that's part one of Armanda. Y'all comment and tell me if you want to know any more of a tale of two worlds. So we'll see y'all later. Bye-bye now.